This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Today on Dreamland, we're going to first have Marco Vigato in a new vision of Atlantis. And it's quite interesting the way he relates ancient mysteries to the archaeological evidence of lost civilizations, which we know are there. Because you can't explain so much of the ruins, we don't even know how they were built around the world. But then something else is going to happen. Last October, I had contact with Anne, and I'm no psychic and I'm no channeler. Well, I may be a little psychic, but I'm not a good channeler because I always worry about my imagination getting in the way. Every so often, quite suddenly, she's there, and I know it. And what happens is usually extraordinary. This time, she talked about, in just a few brief aphorisms, the nature of the body and its relationship to time, and of her, the outside person's relationship to time, the person who is no longer in a body. It's very illuminating material, and it will be in the third half hour of the show. Marco is an Italian living in Mexico, and his accent is a little difficult, but listen up, listen closely. It's well worth listening to his fascinating story. So now let's get on with Dreamland. We're talking to someone we have never talked to on Dreamland before. And given that Dreamland is 20 plus years old, and has thousands upon thousands of interviews, that's saying something. But the reason we talk to new people on the show is we are always exploring. And boy, talk about exploring. Marco Vigato is an explorer of the first order. As you know, on Dreamland, we tend to avoid talking to armchair explorers. We like the people who go out and do it and are there, who look at what's there and take the pictures. Marco certainly does that in his perfectly beautiful book, The Empires of Atlantis, The Origins of Ancient Civilizations and Mystery Traditions Throughout the Ages, shows that in its marvelous pictures. Many Dreamlanders are praising this book. Laird Scranton, who's of course been on the show, Marco Vigato does us the very great service of pulling together many of the salient perspectives on Atlantis. Rand Flemath, a beloved author on this show, hasn't been with us in a long time. He's working on a book. Marco Vigato's quest to merge modern science with the Western esoteric tradition is a daunting goal. And that's why Marco is here, because he succeeded in that. And that's a first. We have a lot of books speculating about the lost past, but very few of them in the context of the esoteric teachings that we have inherited from that past. Mark Carlotto, I haven't had him on Dreamland since 2004, but he mentions the book favorably. Andrew Collins, of course, who is a Dreamland author from way back, Cliff Dunning. Gee, it just seems like we're here among friends. Marco, welcome to Dreamland.
Thank you very much, Whitley. It's a pleasure being on the show.
Well, he's dedicated, just so you know, folks, the past 15 years of his life to this documentary process. This book is not something that was written in 6 months. Not at all. This is a lifetime effort. He's written documentaries, research papers, has degrees from Harvard Business School and Bocconi University. He now lives in Mexico City. He's an Italian native. Let's get to it. All right. One of the first things that struck me about this book is that it covers an enormously vast sweep of time. You're not just talking about the past 12,000 years, which we're familiar with, from the beginning of the Younger Dryas, the end of the Ice Age, to now. You go back 435,000 years. Why is that?
Well, I really wanted to convey the full depth and complexity of Atlantean civilization. As a matter of fact, many books about Atlantis, they only focus on the very last stages of Atlantean civilization, more towards the downfall of Atlantis around the end of the last ice age, the time of the Younger Dryas cataclysm. And they largely ignore the fact that this civilization must clearly have had a very long period of development before that. Actually, if you go back to the testimony of the esoteric tradition, what that suggests is that Atlantean civilization stretched for tens of thousands, even hundreds of thousands of years. There were, in fact, many Atlantean civilizations. And this is what they talk about in the book, and hence the title of the book, The Empires of Atlantis, being like plural, not just one empire, but multiple Atlantean civilizations.
Now, when you say Atlantean, do you mean all in one geographic location that we think of as this lost continent of Atlantis, or do you mean something else?
Well, I would say originating from one same geographic location. What it suggests is that this is, by the way, what also the geological evidence from a range of scientific disciplines suggests is that there was, in fact, a vast mid-Atlantic landmass that sunk towards the end of the last ice age. And they do believe that landmass, which might be identified with the Atlantis of esoteric tradition, was the true cradle of human civilization. Now, from that center, from that point of origin, Atlantean civilization clearly spread throughout the world. It was at some point a truly global civilization that established colonies as far as Egypt and South America, but its heartland, its core, was firmly established in the mid-Atlantic Ocean.
One of the strangest things about all of the unexplainable ancient engineering on planet Earth, and there's a lot of it, is the way most archaeologists and scientists who should be concerned with it ignore it, as if it didn't exist, as if the explanation doesn't matter. But it does matter. And not only that, much of this material, it's not dated. It can't be dated because it's made of stone. What do you think it represents? How old is some of the, are some of these things? Like the material, you've seen all the remains all over the world.
Well, the whole planet is essentially a vast ruins. What it suggests in the book is that the remnants of Atlantean civilization are really all around us. If you go to places like Egypt, like the Giza pyramids, like South America, Tiwanaku, Pumapunku, but really all over the world, you find vestiges of this civilization. Now, because this civilization spanned such a long period of time, as we were just saying, so probably thousands, if not tens of thousands of years, not all these structures would date to the same period. And that's why I think it's also important to understand that whereas some of these constructions may date to the earliest periods, to the earliest times of Atlantean civilization, we also have monuments they call Neo-Atlantean, even post-Atlantean, that still bear the hallmarks of Atlantean science and engineering, but maybe far more recent than some of the other monuments as well. What joins all these different monuments is a set of principles that are the reflection of what I call a sacred science of Atlantean origin. So if you go back to such things as the layout of these monuments, the fact they are so precise and accurately oriented towards the stars, towards the setting and rising of the sun, that suggests that a master plan at some point existed for many of these monuments whose ruins we currently found around the world. And they do believe that that master plan was set probably thousands of years ago during Atlantean times, even though it took many, many generations to carry out that plan.
I'm wondering to ask you, where do we come from? But I'm going to get back to it, because it's the underlying question, I think, in this whole interview. I would like to refer now to Plato, and everybody who studies this even a little bit knows Plato's description of Atlantis in the dialogue, the Timaeus. But you bring up something fascinating in the book. There are other descriptions. The Hindu Puranas and the Bible also contain descriptions of a great island empire that was destroyed and sunk into the Western Ocean. Could you tell us a little bit about some of those references, in particular the Puranas? I didn't even know about that.
Well, there are in fact many such descriptions. Most people will be familiar with Plato's account of Atlantis, but Plato himself never claimed to have invented or made up the Atlantis story. What Plato says in the Timaeus is actually that he picked up the story from his great-grandfather Solon, who in turn had picked it up from Egypt, from the Egyptian priests. And so the origin of Plato's story is actually Egyptian. Plato simply retold the story, might have made some changes, might have modified it so that it would better fit his philosophical and moralistic frameworks. But there can be no doubt that the core of the story itself is actually pre-Greek and most likely Egyptian. And there is actually evidence from the Temple of Edfu in Upper Egypt, from the so-called Edfu building texts, of an account that is remarkably similar to that of Plato, that talks about a lost island, homeland of the gods, that was destroyed, that perished in a cataclysm, and whose survivors later became the founders of Egyptian civilizations. But these are by no means the only account. There are multiple accounts of a lost island homeland that it was at some point the seat of a mighty and powerful civilization. As you mentioned, in the Hindu Puranas, I think we find some of the most fascinating references, both to Atlantis, which is called Atala, and is described as one of the seven climates or one of the seven main continents of the world. It's clearly described as a land situated in the Western Ocean. And there are also many fascinating descriptions of the culture, the civilization of that land, particularly its capital city, which is called the Tripura, the Triple City. And if you read it, the description contained in these ancient Hindu texts, some of which date back to 1500 or 2000 BC, at least in their current editions, you find remarkable analogies with Plato's account. The city of Tripura in the Puranas is described as a city built in concentric rings of land and water, very similar to Plato's description. The destruction of Tripura, its sinking in the Western Ocean also remarkably coincides and reminds us of Plato's description of the sinking of Atlantis. But then you also mentioned the Bible, and this is, I think, one of the most fascinating references. There are actually multiple references in the Bible to a land that vanished. In some cases, like the prophecies that are contained in the Old Testament of the destruction of Tyre, it's very clear that some events of the very remote past are projected into the present time, so that in addressing the king of Tyre in the book of Ezekiel, the biblical author is actually recalling events that might have occurred thousands of years earlier, using again a language that is very much reminiscent of Plato. And even in the book of Revelation, we're talking about the New Testament, the description, the apocalyptic vision of the end of the world with the fall of the great Babylon, which is very curiously also depicted as a mighty island empire, resembles in many ways Plato's account of the corruption and destruction of Atlantis.
Now, going back all of those years, it would mean that there are great cycles which end inevitably in destruction, and we go back again and again and again and have to pick up the pieces, and we end up forgetting our past. Are we living on a tied to a wheel of endless return? What is going on here?
Well, I think that what truly informed not only Plato's vision, but I would say much of the esoteric tradition on Atlantis is an idea of cyclical time, which is quite antithetical to our modern present-day view of time as linear, which is truly a legacy of the Judaic and Christian traditions. So think about the concept, which is the mainstream today, the mainstream view of history, is that of a linear progression that went very similar to the theory of evolution in the biological world, went from simpler forms of civilization, less sophisticated types of human culture, towards more sophisticated cultures and society. However, even if we look back, even without going back thousands of years, if we just look back 1500 years to the time of the fall of the Roman Empire, we have many examples of great civilizations. We could add also the Maya, the Khmer civilization to that. They were at some point mighty and prosperous, and then collapsed, opening the ways, opening the doors to a dark age. We can only wonder how many times this cycle of rise and fall civilization would have repeated itself through history. This is very much in line with ancient worldviews of time as cyclical. The idea of the yuga cycles, for instance, in Hinduism, the concept, which is also present in Greek mythology since the time of Hesiod, of multiple ages of men, in which after a golden age, we go through a silver age, a bronze age, and then finally an iron age, which all repeat themselves in cyclical repetition, really suggests there were multiple cycles of civilization, during which a great civilization rose and fell over periods of many thousands of years. And Atlantis truly represents, also in Plato's works, the civilization of the last golden age. Plato himself states it very clearly that the cataclysm, the destruction of Atlantis, was just the last in order of time. He says that we only remember of one last cataclysm, one great flood, one deluge, but the reality is that there were many cataclysms of fire and water over many thousands of years, and every time humanity had to start over again like children.
I wonder if it's that we live on a very unstable planet with an erratic star, and that we have somehow grown up here and are now being constantly thrown off base. And what's concerning to me, of course, is that we're in another extinction event right now. Now the planet is falling apart around our ears, and we have a situation that nobody talks about except people like you and me and Rand Flamath and Graham Hancock, which is that this planet could become unstable on its axis and change its axial tilt again because of the fact that this happens apparently due to water from the poles. As they melt, the water migrates to the equator until it upsets the planet's balance, and the planet rolls around for a few times before it stabilizes again, and then it's a different place. There's a geodesic line around the Earth which connects places like Machu Picchu, Giza, Angkor Wat, to, if you put a vertical line through the Earth with this horizontal line as a sort of equator, then you find a pole position that would be about 1,500 miles west of where the physical North Pole is now. If the planet is wobbling around like that, what happens to us? What happens to us? We keep being thrown back to the mud and having to drag ourselves back up again, all ignorant of our own past. That's why I think people like you do such an important work. Tell me about the early cataclysms, the ones... Oh, but you know, before you tell me about the early cataclysms, those of you who are listening on the free side Listen to this.
This is not communication. It's communion. Hundreds of thousands of people have claimed contact. That will change you. It changed me.
Lost it.
This was something that I kept buried for years. Strange things would happen. I didn't want anything to do with it anymore.
He came at me, and I fought for my life.
Ships started to pop up in the sky.
And there's this bizarre disk of light. And it's moving across the sky very fast.
The experience is often very terrifying.
If I felt fear, I would crawl under my covers, hoping that it would go away, whatever it was.
I know that we were put in that craft.
I knew I was going to go to another planet.
And the being was right next to my face.
He saw two shadow beings. That's when I felt like I was going to die.
I had a real encounter with something. Even if I had to live with the fear, is to know the truth, is to know.
This is Whitley Strieber. Listen to me now from June of 2010, talking to Alan Lammers about an incredible thing that happened to him on the island of Sulawesi in Indonesia. Here you are in South Sulawesi in the little town in the district of Sandu Batu. What happened? You were told something rather strange.
Well, we were told before we went, my friends that I work with the NGO, they told me that when you pack, because it kind of happened by accident, I went out to buy a raincoat. It rains quite a bit in this part of the world. And so I went out and I bought a yellow raincoat. And my friend said, I'm sorry, you can't take that to Walla Walla. And I said, well, why not? And he says, well, you can't wear that color. So anyways, excuse me. So I thought, okay, well, what colors can I wear? They said, well, you can only wear black or white. You cannot wear any bright colors, no bright green, especially no yellow, and, you know, that's all you should bring. And I said, well, what would happen? And they said, well, people disappear.
You will find the rest of that story, and it is brain-bending, in the June 5th edition of Dreamland, June 5, 2010 edition of Dreamland in the unknowncountry.com archive. This archive is one of the richest of its kind in the world, probably is the richest of its kind in the world, filled with extraordinary shows, of which this show is certainly one, this show with Alan Lammers. You will never have heard anything like it. It does what Dreamland is here to do. It opens your mind to the fact that we live inside a hidden reality that we prefer not to acknowledge, but not here. Here on unknowncountry.com, we do acknowledge it. We live in it and we love it. Subscribe today. You can't go wrong. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and get started.
We're talking to Marco Vigato. His new book, The Empires of Atlantis, the origins of ancient civilizations and mystery traditions throughout the ages. And his website is marcovigato.com. Now, I was asking before we took the break about the early times and what happened then, do you think? The very early civilizations, when they collapsed.
Well, there were actually many cataclysms, as you say, some of which were man-made, some others were clearly caused by a variety of causes, including cosmic impacts, changes in the orientation, the tilt of the Earth's axis, polar wandering. Might have been many, many different causes. Now, the first major cataclysm that is recorded in not only the esoteric tradition, but also a number of historical sources around the world, seems to have occurred around 35,000 years BC. This is what I refer to as the first Atlantean cataclysm. It also marked the beginning of the sinking of these now lost and sunken mid-Atlantic landmass. As to the exact cause of this cataclysm, of course, we can only speculate. In Babylonian sources, it was described as the first great flood, the first great deluge. It is a date that is actually marked in the records of Sumeria and of Babylon, in the writings of Berossus, as well as in cuneiform king lists. So we actually possess relatively precise information about the date of the cataclysm. We do not know what the causes of that cataclysm were, and that's where the esoteric tradition can also help to shed some light on the events of that time. What is suggested in the esoteric tradition is that at that time, a division of Atlantean society took place, a war between two opposing factions, which led to a misuse of technology. And this is what, according to the esoteric tradition, precipitated the first Atlantean cataclysm. Now, there is also the belief that in earlier times, before the cataclysm, the Earth enjoyed a sort of perpetual golden age. There was a time when the Earth's axis spun perfectly perpendicular, and this would have created some very interesting conditions on our planet, almost equal to an eternal spring. The length of day and night would have been constant throughout the year at the pole, so you would have had almost constant sunset, almost. So it would have been definitely a very interesting, very different world. This is what many ancient sources describe as the primeval golden age, associated with the concept of eternal spring, which truly means an eternal equinox. So, now, after the cataclysm is when the cycles of the seasons, the cycles of time, truly started. The inclination, the tilt of the Earth's axis changed, and this is what precipitated a set of cataclysms. Now, we can only imagine the extent of the devastation that could be provoked by a change, even assuming that it would have been a gradual change in the tilt of the Earth's axis. You must imagine enormous tidal waves, hurricane force winds sweeping through the planet. So that would have devastated any civilization, any culture that existed on the planet at that time.
Well, before the ice ages started, and they started 2.8 million years ago when the when Central America rose up out of the sea, there was a very, very long period where the weather was very stable. And I suppose that you're talking about that period as being the period when the axis was vertical to the sun, because there would have been, it would have been a profoundly different world, and a world that didn't offer the kind of challenge that we experienced during the Ice Age. We went into the last ice age naked and climbing around in trees, and came out of it clothed and running along the ground, because we had We had to in order to survive. Nature was challenging us. And I see vaguely a sort of larger scale plan, I guess I would call it here. And do you think that this continuous all of these upheavals, is there, do you think, a plan of any kind behind them? Is there someone there?
Well, I don't think necessarily someone, but I do definitely think that there might be an explanation for these recurring cycles. The ancients, at least, seem to believe that these cataclysms could be, to some extent, predicted, that they will repeat cyclically at intervals of time. And quite curiously, when you look at ancient chronologies, ancient traditions about previous ages of men and recurring cataclysms, they all seem to converge on a period of around 25,000 years between successive cataclysms, which, by the way, also happens to be almost to the year the period of the precession of the equinoxes. Now, I think that there is a very deep mystery here, because if we just look at what is the mainstream scientific explanation of precession, it is just attributed to a small wobble in the Earth's axis, which causes the tilt of the Earth's axis to shift very gradually over periods of 25,000 years. But this is enough for the sun to rise in different constellations over periods of time. So we can observe the effects of precession if we look at the rising and setting of the sun, for instance, at the equinoxes, and we observe that over many thousands of years, it's as if the background of the star shifts with respect to the sun. That's the concept of precession. However, the ancients also had different interpretations of a precession. They actually attributed it to the influence of a nearby star. This is a hypothesis that's been resurrected and revived in recent years, among others, by Walter Cruttendon, who suggests that this star might have been the star Sirius, which has a number of very significant, very anomalous properties. What Cruttendon suggests is that the Sun and Sirius are actually part of a binary system that's gone pretty undetected for thousands of years, and certainly to modern science. And what this causes, or better, like the gravitational effect of the interplay between the Sun and Sirius, is actually the cause of all these recurring cataclysms as our Sun or entire solar system approaches gets farther from the common center of gravity of this binary star system.
Well, by the way, subscribers, if you're interested in Walter Cruttendon's work, there's a wonderful interview of him on Dreamland on the website. You can just put in the insert the word Cruttendon, Cruttenden, into the search engine, and you will find him there. The other thing that I think I find so fascinating about this is the fact that there seems to be a continuous state of war. The distant past was full of wars, not only cataclysms but wars. Let's talk a little bit about the War of the Nephilim, if we can, of the Nephilim. Mm-hmm. And who were they? Well, yeah. I mean, I've asked half a dozen or maybe a dozen guests that question, and each one has come up with a fascinating answer. So I'm asking you to.
Well, if you go back to the teachings of many esoteric traditions throughout the world, you always find these great war, this opposition between two different factions that might have originated on Atlantis, but then went on to become truly the root of many of our modern human cultures. So there is this idea, particularly in the system of theosophy, of multiple humanities or multiple human races that exist in the remote past. And so right now we live in the fifth fifth epoch, whereas the Atlantean epoch would have been the fourth. And with each epoch, there is a new, a different humanity. So in this process, you always have a conflict between different humanities or different races, to use the language of theosophy, which truly represent different stages of evolution, so that at the end of the Atlantean period, the fourth race had to give way to the fifth race, which is the one to which all of anatomically modern humans living today belong. And this fight, this great struggle between Atlantean and what, again, in the language of theosophy, is called Aryan or modern humanity, is also portrayed in a number of traditions around the world. It's usually portrayed as a fight between the old gods and the new gods. For instance, in Greek mythology, you have the myth of the war of the Titans and the gods, whereas the new gods, champion by Zeus, were able to overthrow Cronos and the Titans, that represented an earlier generation of gods. Very similar also in Hindu mythology, you have the war of the Devas and the Asuras. In Norse mythology, you have the Vanir and the Aesir, the old and the new gods. So this is a theme that we find very consistently across world mythologies. Now, going to your question specifically about the Nephilim, the Bible, particularly the book of Genesis, suggests that the Nephilim were truly the hybrid progeny of the sons of God and the daughters of men. There is actually a passage in Genesis 6 in which it is said that the sons of God came unto the daughters of men and had children from them, which were the Nephilim. Now, in order to unravel the puzzle, you would need to know who these sons of God were. What he suggests is that these sons of God were, in fact, Atlanteans. So there was a reference to a previous world age, to a previous humanity, Atlantean humanity, that fell through a misuse of technology, of also their spiritual powers, hence the stigma associated in the Bible with the fallen angels and the Nephilim as their progeny. And it sounds like these Atlanteans were responsible for the creation of modern humanity, for the creation of the Nephilim as a hybrid species between Atlanteans and some other hominin that existed already on the planet at that time. Could have been Neanderthal, could have been Homo erectus, Denisovan. And so what it suggests is truly that modern humanity is a hybrid species, the result of the admixture of Atlantean DNA with some other hominin DNA.
You speak of in the book, excuse me, folks, I'm natural, now that I'm on, I'm visible, my chair knows this and is torturing me. I may have to stop the show for a minute and try to fix it, but right now we're going to keep going. You mention in the book star cities. And you mentioned specifically in central Italy, in ancient Latium, mm-hmm. there are these remains of these cities that are referenced to different constellations. And it reminded me, of course, of Giza, where the pyramids fit the stars of the constellation Orion. And this was a very ancient way of identifying cities with certain constellations. But what did it mean? Why did they do that? Because there are a lot of reasons, among them, not the least of which is, were they saying, this is where I came from? We in this city came from this constellation? Or is it that they honored it in some way? But it's just, it seems, without knowing anything about the cultures that did this, it seems like a very odd thing to just spontaneously do. There had to be a major reason for it.
Absolutely. And this is, again, a pattern that you find throughout the world. You find star cities or sites that are meant to align with the stars, with specific constellations in the sky, pretty much all over the world. You mentioned several examples like Central Italy, Giza. There is evidence that many of the ancient Maya cities were also built according to a similar stellar arrangement. Angkor in Cambodia is also another prime example of that, as the entire city was laid out in the shape of the constellation of Draco. Now, what he suggests is that this was done not only for symbolic reason, but there might have been also some very practical reasons behind that, which may go back to a system of beliefs in what they call talismanic magic. This idea of the earth as the mirror of heaven, or the place where celestial energies get transferred onto the surface of our planet, is a fundamental idea, is a fundamental concept of Hermetism, which is that great esoteric cultural tradition that emerged during the Hellenistic period, but probably had its origins much farther back into very remote antiquity. And now, according to Hermetic beliefs, to create an image of something actually endowed it with the powers of the thing, so that creating an image of the sky or certain constellation was in a way a form of establishing a direct link, a direct connection with that constellation, with the powers that were associated with that constellation. Now, all of these might sound like strange and weird fantasies today, but in a world that was so imbued with these beliefs in talismanic magic, it was perfectly rational and perfectly logical as a way of literally transferring celestial powers on Earth. Now, why was it done? I do believe that this was done in order to propitiate and bring forth the beginning of a new golden age, something that associates all of these different star cities and sites mirroring the stars and the heavens around the world, is the fact that they all seem to point to the same date. If we look back, for instance, at the configuration of the pyramids on the Giza plateau, which many authors, beginning with Robert Bovall, have suggested mirror the constellation of Orion, particularly the belt
right.
of Orion. However, if we look at the correspondence, it's only perfect around 10,450 BC, so much earlier than the assumed date of construction, at least by mainstream Egyptology, of the Giza pyramids. It's also the same in the case of Angkor in Cambodia, where the entire city was designed to mirror the constellation of Draco, but not as it would have looked like in the 12th and 13th century AD when the city was built, but rather in 10,450 BC. So it's almost as if by deliberately replicating the pattern of the heavens, the pattern of the skies, as it looked like before, around the time of the last terrestrial cataclysm, all these monuments were meant in a way to replicate the heavens as they looked like at the time of the last golden age, as a way, therefore, of propitiating, perhaps in a way, the return of that golden age.
Yeah, inducing the return of the golden
Correct.
Age, yes, drawing it via sympathetic magic. We made brief reference a little while ago to the precession of the equinox, but there's much more there, and let me explain myself. The ages of the equinox are, first of all, folks, it's about 2,200 years, and each age the world changes, as Marco was saying, but there seems to be a level of planning there that's really very strange. I'll give you an example. Jesus was born under the sign of Pisces, the fish. The fish swims around in water with in given is given everything he needs to survive. He doesn't have to worry about it. He is swimming in the waters of the earth. We are that little fish. We are that embryo swimming in the waters of the earth. Then along comes Aquarius, and he pours the waters out. And the little fish ends up on dry land. Now, what do we do? But if you look back further to Taurus, the great bull cults of the Mediterranean and of the Indian subcontinent all rose during that 2,200-year period. And also with the ram, the age of the ram is the same thing. The Bible mentions the ram more than any other animal. And it was written during that particular part of the precession of the equinox. So it almost looks like there's a great plan here. And I kind of return to that. It's looking more and more to me like this isn't an accident. That there's somebody behind the curtain, that the Wizard of Oz is damn real.
UnknownCountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe, in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations. But more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real, and it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future.
Three words: advanced aerial threat. Who in the CIA, NSA, DIA tells at least the United States of America that we're not alone in this universe? We have never been alone in this universe.
The U.S. government really has kept that secret, not only from the American people, which is bad enough, but even kept it from itself.
The UFO community has been portrayed as conspiracy theorists and tinfoil hats, and we're crazy. And the government is now admitting that UFOs are real, and disclosure is here. Suddenly, they're our friend? No.
America's defense establishment is finally admitting some of what it knows.
This could have been a chance to say we're going to collaborate with the representatives of the people in what is supposed to be a government of, by, and for the people.
If what they tell you is the truth, there is no need to withhold it from public.
We've entered a quantum age, making a leap not only in technology, but also in consciousness. Companies are now creating non-sentient replacement humans. They look just like you and I. They're intended for customer service and things such as that, but these neons, as they're called, could be more nefarious than that.
We're dealing with a fight. There are forces behind the scenes that doesn't want any of this information to come out.
There's still a lot of truth that has yet to be revealed.
I was one of those quote unquote men in black, but I realize it's probably better now to be known as men in white, bringing truth to the topic.
The problem with the truth is the truth might be terrifying.
What do you think?
Well, yes, I do think actually if you look back and you've mentioned a number of examples like the sequence of the ages, the cult of the ram, the cult of the bull, before that Gemini, even earlier, you find these represented in many ancient cultures. It's actually quite remarkable to see the influence that these star symbolism had on the development of human culture and civilization. For instance, in the case of the bull cult of the Minoans, it went on to inspire an entire civilization. You have many examples in Egypt of the cult of the ram of Amun, and that it seems in a way that not only human civilization or artistic expressions were influenced by the cycle of a procession, but the underlying all of these was actually a very precise knowledge of the influence of procession, of the influence of the heavens.
Yes.
On earth. Which is also what is suggested by so many mythical traditions. There is actually another, I think, fundamental book for the understanding of the ancient mindset, which is Hamlet's Mill by Santillanian Foundation that talks about that, talks about the sort of code of a procession that originated seemingly in remote prehistory, because we find traces of it since the time of the earliest Egyptian dynasties or the earliest Mesopotamian dynasties as well, and survived remarkably intact through a variety of myths, a variety of traditions that talk about the heroes that lived in the sky and all these constellations. So perhaps in all these myths, the ancients wanted to embed a warning as well to future generations about the cataclysms that tend to occur at specific junctions in the cycle of procession. That might be the whole message behind all these myths that relate to procession, and these the great importance that was attributed in ancient times to the sequence, the rise and fall of the ages along the processional cycle.
Remarkable. There's someone there, someone that we don't know. I wrote a book called Jesus, A New Vision, which I think shows quite clearly that there was planning involved in what happened to Jesus, and the people who were involved in doing that appear, but very like almost ghostly in the New Testament texts. But they were there. Do you think that there's a level of humanity that knows more than the average person does, and that is perhaps engaged in shepherding mankind into what looks to me like birth? I think the species is going to be born. But to be born, the waters of the earth are going to have to break. And when that happens, it's going to be hell for us. But on the other side, maybe a new life.
Mm-hmm. Well, I do think there have always been mystery traditions and esoteric schools that possess or claim to possess some pieces of that truth, of that knowledge that at some point existed as a single whole and then became fragmented across a myriad of different threads. And that, I do believe, if we actually look back at the like sequence of the chain of transmission of esoteric tradition in the West, that there might in fact have been deliberate plan carried out by various groups to ensure the survival of these sacred knowledge for the benefit of future humanity. Now, would you suggest about like different cycles of civilization, that one cycle has to end in order for a new humanity, a new cycle to be born? Again, I think it's very much in line with the teachings of theosophy, for instance, that suggests that just in the same way as Atlantean humanity had to disappear for a new humanity that of the present age to arise, in the very same way, I think modern humanity, the humanity of the present cycle, is destined to be replaced by a new humanity. And many believe that we are now at that very critical junction in history, with the dawn, the beginning of the age of Aquarius, that will actually give birth to this new humanity, or to a new golden age.
That's right. And yet, haven't there been golden ages in the past? There have been. So who wants another golden age if it's doomed to be destroyed again? And is there someone destroying it, or is it just natural that that this is happening?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think, again, this is a very fundamental, almost ontological question, right? Like, what is truly the cause of the rise and fall of the ages? Certainly, as you say, there have been multiple golden ages in the past, which have all more or less ended in cataclysm. However, even though that would almost suggest a cyclical repetition, repetition is never cyclical. There is always a process of evolution, so that every new race, every new humanity can learn from the previous one. And even though it may be itself doomed, at least if we look at this cycle from the perspective of even greater cycles, perhaps, what we see is still a process of evolution. When I talk about evolution, I do not necessarily imply just like physical or biological evolution. I talk more about spiritual evolution. So it's an ongoing process in which periodically humanity is tested through cataclysms, to periods of hardships, so that it can overcome its own boundaries and reach the next level of spiritual development.
You speak of the enigma of Yahweh, and it's really quite an enigma, because he, as you say, he's pictured in the Old Testament as a physical creature with typically human needs and frailties. There's nothing like that in most literature about the gods and about sacred things from that era. But it's quite true. He isn't a nice God at all. And what is this enigma? Could we be looking at something that, if we could look through it, we would look very deep into the past indeed? That this God is actually a very old figure whose relevance to the present generation has changed or never recovered?
Mm-hmm. I think this all goes back to the divisions that appeared in the world after the fall of Atlantis. What it suggests is that with the fall of Atlantis, you had, on the one hand, the survivors from the fourth cycle, from the Atlantean cycle, but then you already had modern humanity, again, to use the language of theosophy, Aryan humanity. And these two races, or these two cultures, were deeply antagonistic to each other. So you had, on the one hand, the still like surviving remnants, or the fourth root race, and the rising fifth root race. And so in that struggle that is also portrayed in the Bible, I find an echo of that tension of that war between the fourth and the fifth root races. Actually, when you find such episodes in the Bible as the destruction of Nephilim, which I think is truly a fundamental episode and really reveals so much about what might have been going on at the time. What you find there is a description almost of different spheres, different areas of influence in the world, as if the world had been divided among different powers. Some still sided with the old Atlantean world order, and some other ones sided with the new world order of the fifth race. So it's very clear. For instance, I find it fascinating when the Bible describes the campaigns of conquest that were carried out by the Israelites in the land of Canaan, that the Bible calls for the extermination of the people of Canaan as descendants of the Nephilim, as if there was something impure that had to be eliminated. It's almost the description of a genocide that we find with the extermination of the Nephilim was carried out by the Israelites in the land of Canaan. And of course, the Israelites were championed in that by Yahweh, which, as I suggest in the book, is very curiously portrayed not as an ethereal God, the creator of all things, as we would imagine, but as a being or an entity that looks remarkably similar to a human being, maybe a very evolved, a very advanced human being, but still like a flesh and bones entity, not a spiritual God that leads his army into war and is motivated by violent passion. So what I suggest, just to summarize, is that In the biblical descriptions of the Exodus, the wars for the conquest of Canaan, we find an echo of that struggle between the remnants of Atlantean humanity and their descendants, the Nephilim, the Canaanites, and the champions of the new human race, in this case the Israelites, with their god, Yahweh.
The question of time comes up when you're talking about the kings, the lists of kings, and it was very interesting to me. It's a very telling point that these lists were made by somebody who, or copied from somebody, I should say, who had a better ability to measure time than the people who wrote them down. Mm-hmm. Who were they? Do you have any idea?
Well, that's a very interesting point you bring up, because we find many of these king lists in Mesopotamia and Egypt that actually stretch back very far into prehistory. In the case of Egypt, they go back over 30,000 years. They mention several generations, several dynasties of gods and demigods. In the case of Babylon, they go as far back as 430,000 years ago. Now, for a very long time, our only source for reconstructing some of these king lists were the works of the classical authors and the later Christian authors that copied these lists. For instance, we have the writings of Manetho in Egypt, of Berossus in Babylon. Now, with the first archaeological excavations, particularly in Mesopotamia, Nippur, and Nineveh, we actually uncovered some of the original documents upon which these lists were based. They were cuneiform tablets, cuneiform records. So we now have the original sources upon which Berossus based his account and his king list stretching back over 400,000 years, which, again, in some cases, these cuneiform records, they date back to the very beginning of civilization, almost 3000 BC.
Yes.
Now, what is curious, however, is that when you look at these texts, you conduct more of philological analysis, you realize that these texts, even though they're probably some of the earliest documents, the earliest written documents of humanity, they show evidence of having been also copies of earlier texts. There are many lacunas in the text and many passages in which the scribes themselves say that they could not understand the originals, so they could not translate them. We suggest that whatever originals they copied, and again, we're talking about the time 5,000 years ago, 3000 BC, they did not understand them, be it because they were too ruined, be it because they were written in an entirely different language that was unknown to them, or that they did no longer understand. But it's very clear that these kings list, or at least the ones that have survived to this day, were but copies of much earlier documents. We can only imagine how old these documents would be if some of the earliest surviving examples of this kings list date back to almost 5,000 years ago. Now, another very interesting aspect of this king's list is their remarkable precision. In some cases, they are as detailed as recording not only the number of years attributed to a specific king or dynasty, but even the months and days that they ruled. So they were really confronted with a very accurate form of timekeeping, which many would not suspect even existed or could even exist 5,000 years ago. And then, of course, we are confronted with the fact that this king's list, they contain a record of events of dynasties and kings that date back and that stretch back tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of years before the beginning of recorded history. That's the real mystery.
You know, there are skulls here and there, quite a few of them in Peru. I'm referring, of course, to the ones with elongated heads. And it's always said that, oh, this is easily dismissed. This is done by a custom of head binding. But that's not quite the answer, is it? Could you tell us a little bit more about those skulls?
Yes, I think it's both, because certainly the practice of cranial deformation at some point spread throughout the world. We find the examples of cranial deformation pretty much in every ancient culture. And I think this is in and of itself quite interesting, because that suggests that these individuals that they wanted to look like, to resemble, probably already possessed as an inherited trait that characteristic of having a very elongated skull, or to use a medical term, what is called a dolichocephalic skull. So that because that was a characteristic of the elite of that race, of these very advanced elite at some point came to be worshipped as gods by ancient civilization, people wanted also to look like their gods, hence the practice of cranial deformation. Now, here is, when we talk about the cranial deformation, we're talking about a practice that tried to alter and change the shape of the skull of infants, mostly. A very different thing, however, is the possibility that some of these skulls might have belonged to individual that inherited as a genetically inherited trait that peculiarly elongated shape of the skull. And this is what I believe is the case with many elongated skulls found, for instance, in Peru, in Bolivia, in South Africa, as well as in the case of Boskop men, that not only show an anomalous shape and configuration of the skull, but also a much larger brain capacity than what is typically found in modern humans. Now, if you were to assume that these skulls were just a result of artificial cranial deformation, what that does is really only changing and deforming the shape of the skull, but should not in principle increase the size of the brain. Whereas what you find in many of these examples from South America are brain capacities well in excess of those attested for modern humans, which suggests that some of these skulls at least might have belonged to people that possessed a very different physical and probably also intellectual characteristics from the rest of the population.
This has been an absolutely fascinating conversation, and I want to continue it at some point in time. The book is The Empires of Atlantis, and if we learned anything here today, it is that there has been a very great loss in human history, and more than one. And that the little ship Earth is rolling on a sea of interstellar storms and solar storms. And we are the victims of this. And it looks like this could happen again very soon. So let me ask you this. In trying to recover this information from mankind, what is your motive for doing so, if I may ask a final question?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I think it is, in a sense, our duty to recover that information, everything that we know, everything that's been transmitted to us from the remote past suggests that these civilization was trying a way to convey a message, to send us a message from remote antiquity. And we now have a responsibility of trying to decipher and to understand this message. Also, suggest in the book the possibility that this civilization was, in a way, also aware or had at least foresight of its own impending doom or the cataclysm that was going to happen, and therefore decided to preserve some of its knowledge in repositories, holds of records in different parts of the world, so that at least some of the knowledge of the antediluvian world could be preserved for the benefit of future humanity. And I now believe that with the technology of today, with our knowledge that we possess, it might be possible to recover that vast body of knowledge once again. What I envision is a new renaissance, very much in the same way as the rediscovery of the classical texts of classical antiquity of Greece and Rome during the Middle Ages was what triggered the renaissance and basically setting the foundations of our modern civilization. I do think that the recovery of the knowledge of the Atlantean past, of the records of the Atlantean past, can really bring forth and open up a new renaissance, a new golden age for mankind.
The Empires of Atlantis, Marco Vigato. Marco, thank you very much for being with us today on Dreamland.
It was my pleasure. Thank you so much, Whitley.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Anne Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.